I'm Evelyn Kiptot. I'm a social scientist. I work for the World Agroforestry Center, and I'm based in Nairobi, Kenya. I'm going to talk about adaption, and the topic I'm looking at is adaption or pseudo-adaption, dynamics of the use of improved tree fallows by farmers in Western Kenya. I'll start by giving a short introduction to Western Kenya. Later on, I'll briefly give a historical background of soil fertility research in that particular region, the statement of the problem, objectives, methods, results, and finally I'll finish by giving a few recommendations and conclusions. This is Western Kenya. It is an area that is densely populated. Population density in one of the districts called Siaya is about 300 people per square kilometer, whereas in Vihiga, one of the study sites, the population density is over 1,000 people per square kilometer. Farm sizes range between 0.5 to 2 hectares. And because of the small land sizes, farmers continuously crop with little or no fertilizer because most of them cannot afford to use fertilizer. The result of this, soil fertility is very, very low, and this has resulted in very low maize yields, which are less than 1 ton per hectare. Some farmers use manure, but the quality and quantity is usually very, very low. Just to take you back to historical background of soil fertility research in Western Kenya. In the 1980s, the World Agroforestry Center carried out a diagnostic study to find out the problems affecting crop productivity in Western Kenya. And they did find out that soil fertility was one of the major problems that was contributing to low agricultural productivity. So based on those findings, there was a research center that was established in Western Kenya in a place called Maseno by Kenya Forest Research Institute in collaboration with ICRAF and Kenya Agriculture Research Institute, mainly to address the soil fertility problems that are affecting farmers in that particular region. So research began to identify suitable low-cost agroforestry options that would address the soil fertility problem. One of the low-cost soil fertility options that the researchers came up with during that time was known as improved tree fallows or improved tree and shrub fallows. This involves the deliberate planting of fast-growing trees and shrubs, which are usually leguminous. They fix nitrogen, and therefore they're able to improve our soil fertility. Planting of these shrubs is usually done at very, very high density, and these trees or shrubs mature within 6 to 1 year. And once they mature, the farmers cut them, and then they plant maize or whatever crop that they want to plant. So there are various species that have been used for improved fallows in Western Kenya. We have Tephrosia vogeli, which is one of the best species that has been found to tremendously increase our soil fertility. We have species such as Calandra, which is also good for fodder. We have different varieties of Clotaralia, which are also very, very good for soil fertility. So initially, there was a very low adoption of this particular practice in Western Kenya, and this is because of the extension approach that was being used at that particular time. This involved the top-down approach, on station and technologies transferred to extension officers who in turn would disseminate them to farmers. And extension officers used contact farmers who in most cases were of a higher social status than the farmers within the community, and therefore there was a disconnect and the farmers were not able to, could not adapt these technologies. So after the various institutions were collaborating in improving soil fertility in Western Kenya realized that there was very low adoption, they came up with another project in 1997 to develop a participatory approach that was used to disseminate this soil fertility technologies. And this particular approach was known as the village committee approach. It is a community-based participatory approach. It involved, it aimed at reaching all farmers within a village by working with groups and individual farmers. In Western Kenya, almost about 90% of farmers belong to groups, so it was found quite convenient for researchers to work with farmers in groups. So these groups delegated a member to represent them in the village committees. These committees were used as contact points for development projects. So the technologies that were therefore developed were done jointly between the farmers, within the farmers, of course, through their groups, and then they would be passed on to the village committees, who would then disseminate to their fellow farmers within their groups. So it was presumed that members of these village committees would facilitate faster spread of these practices to their groups and other community members. So later on, after about 2, 3, 4 years of using this participatory approach, known as the village approach, the three institutions decided to shift focus to provision of credit. They realized that although nitrogen was a limiting factor in Western Kenya, they found that some areas also were deficient in phosphorus, and therefore they needed to find a source of phosphorus. The leguminous shrubs are only able to provide nitrogen. And of course, they also needed to supplement this with phosphorus. So another project was started whereby they provided farmers with credit where they would get inorganic fertilizer, which they would use in order to improve soil fertility. So farmers were provided with credit in the form of inputs that was paid with interest at the end of the cropping season. After all these, there was very little understanding of what was happening in terms of adoption. So I came in and undertook a study to understand the adoption process of what had been going on in Western Kenya, the adoption of the soil fertility improvement technologies in Western Kenya. And I wanted to understand the adoption process over a long period of time. And I looked at the wider socioeconomic, political, and institutional setting in which farmers are embedded. The main objective was actually to look at the adaption process of improved tree fallows by farmers in Western Kenya over a span of 8 years. Why is it important to study the adaption process over a longer time frame? When you're dealing with agroforestry, you're dealing with trees, and trees take a longer period of time to mature. And therefore, you need a longer period to study the adaption process. And this involves experimentation, which may take 2 to 3 years. And of course, when you study the adaption process over a longer period of time, you're able to differentiate between those farmers who are just experimenting, those farmers who are non-adapters, who never actually took up the technologies. You're able to differentiate the adapters, and even those who adapted, rejected, and later on readapted. So it is important that adaption is carried out within a longer period of time so that you can be able to differentiate between the various categories of farmers. We used various methods. We used a formal survey, and in addition to that, we also had interviews with key informants. And I also used what we call participant observation. This method is used to understand the behavior of individual farmers, attitudes, and their level of participation in various activities. Participant information involves the researcher living with the community, and from time to time, this researcher has to be engaged in the activities of the farmers. That way, the person will be able to, observe what the farmers are doing. And then the other method I used was the case study approach, where I was able to explore analytical issues with a few farmers so that I could get a deep understanding of issues that were identified using the other methods. The findings of the surveys were very interesting, and I was able to look at the adaption over a span of 8 years, and the graph shows the percentage of farmers that adapted the improved fallow technologies over a span of 8 years. And you can, from the graph, you can see that in 1999, there was adoption was quite high, and then later on it dropped into the year 2000, and it picked up in 2001, and then the peak was in 2002. And then after 2002, there was a drop in the number of farmers who were taken up improved fallow technologies. And the explanation for this is that when the project started, it provided seed, free seed of these improved fallow species to farmers so that they could set up these practices on their farms. And because the seeds were not enough, what the project did was it encouraged those farmers who had seed to sell to the project so that they could distribute to other farmers within the community. And what happened is that they developed a market for this seed, and therefore so many farmers got interested in this particular technology because they were able to sell their seed and get some income. And then it reached some point where the market was so saturated with seed and the project stopped buying this seed. And what happened is that some of the farmers who only took up the practice because of the seed market abandoned these technologies. And then later on, when the project brought in the issue of credit, so some of these farmers who had actually dropped the use of these practices then again planted these improved fallows because they wanted to benefit from the credit. And after some time, of course, the project ended and there was no more credit, and therefore those farmers who just planted the fallows because of the credit stopped planting the improved fallows. So from this analysis, I was able to characterize the farmers into various different categories. One of the categories were the non-adapters. These are farmers who had access to the technology over the 8-year period, but they never planted improved fallows. And then the other category were the testers and the rejecters. These are farmers who tried the technology, that is the use of improved fallows, for 3 years or less, but who no longer practice. After some time, they tried it and then they said, this doesn't work for us, so they stopped. And then there are those who are genuine testers. These are farmers who genuinely experimented the technology and they found it was useful to them, and they adapted. Then we have what I categorize as the pseudo-adapters. These are farmers who tried the improved fallows with their different objectives. They tried the improved fallows as a means to get free inputs from the project. Some of them did it as a means to get an opportunity to participate in tours and seminars which were being organized by the project. Others did it as a means to access credit, because the project was providing free inputs, which of course they were required to pay at the end of the cropping season. So some of the farmers just took up the technology because they wanted to get the free credit. And then others took up these technologies because of the seed market, because the project was actually buying seed from farmers, their market for seed, and therefore some farmers wanted to, you know, just get an income from selling seed to the project. And others just took up the technologies because of prestige. They wanted to show their fellow farmers that they're taking up the technologies because they were being visited by a project staff, being visited by visitors, so they were doing it because of prestige. So you can see that the pseudo-adapters had so many reasons why they took up their technologies. But once the project ended, then they disadapted, because ideally the reason for them taking up the technologies was for their own, for them to get some benefits from the project. And of course there are those who stopped because of lack of resources, such as labor. And some stopped and then readapted, of course, because of the anticipated benefits. Looking at the results of the adaption, we were doing this work in two districts in Western Kenya, and there were more adapters in one of the districts in Siaya than there were in Vihiga district. The reason for this is basically as a result of land sizes. In the beginning, I mentioned that the farm sizes in Vihiga about 0.5 hectares, while in Siaya, about average of 1 hectare. So farmers in Siaya have more land than those in Vihiga. And that's the reason why there are more adapters in Siaya than there were in Vihiga. This is because we are talking about shrubs, and these shrubs take up land, and when you're dealing with farmers who have very little land sizes, their main priority is to plant food crops, not trees, and therefore that's the reason why there was more adaption in Siaya than there was in Vihiga districts. So some of the factors that we found to influence adaption was, of course, the farm size. And the factors that did not influence adoption of these improved fallows were education, age of the farmer, gender, ownership of livestock, and farmers as status in the group. We also did ask farmers why they rejected or abandoned the improved fallow technology. And about 42% of farmers in Siaya say they did abandon the technology because of the small farm size, whereas over 80% in Vihiga said they did abandon the technology also because of small farm sizes. Others said they did abandon because of no increase in crop yield. Some of them did not observe any increase in yield. Some of them abandoned because of lack of a market for the seed. And others said they abandoned because there were no edible products from these shrubs. So for them, they were looking at tangible benefits, and soil fertility to them was really not a tangible benefit. They wanted something that was edible, and that's the reason why they abandoned the planting of improved fallow species. In conclusion, I would say that adaption is a highly variable and dynamic process, which is influenced by so many factors which go beyond the household and at the farm level. So it is important that if one is studying the adaption process, they have to look at factors that go beyond the household. You have to look at institutional factors, you have to look at the policy environment in order to be able to understand the adaption process. And for the soil fertility potential of leguminous fallow species to be realized, more tangible and immediate benefits must be visible to farmers in order for them to forego a season's crop. Because if you're working in an area where land sizes are very small, and we all know that farmers' number one priority is food security, then if you bring in a tree component that is not providing immediate benefits, such as food, farmers will not go for it. Soil fertility is a long-term benefit, and for it, especially when they have very small farm sizes. And above all, I would say that context under which technological interventions take place has to be understood thoroughly. If the context is not conducive for the technology, adoption then will not simply take place. To elaborate on this, I'll say if you have very small farm sizes where farmers have to grow food crops, and then you bring in a tree component that is going to take up land that is meant for the food crops, farmers are not going to go for that particular technology unless that particular technology will provide products that farmers can be able to sell and maybe buy food. So projects have to be aware. And also, they should not just measure the number or proportion of farmers who are adapting the technologies, but they also need to look at the pseudo-adapters because there are farmers who plan for reasons that have nothing to do with the benefits of the practice. Thank you.